ಭುಜಂತಂ ರಾಮ ರಾಮೇತಿ ಮಧುರಂ ಮಧುರಾಕ್ಷರಂ ಆರುಹ್ಯ ಕವಿತಾ ಶಾಖಾಂ ವಂದೇ ವಾಲ್ಮೀಕಿ ಕೋಕಿಲಂ ಯತ್ರ ಯತ್ರ ರಘುನಾಥ ಕೀರ್ತನಂ ತತ್ರ ತತ್ರ ಕೃತ ಮಸ್ತಕಾಂಜಲಿಂ ಬಾಷ್ಪವಾರಿ ಪರಿಪೂರ್ಣ ಲೋಚನಂ ಮಾರುತಿಂ ನಮತ ರಾಕ್ಷಸಾಂತಕಂ ವೈದೇಹೀ ಸಹಿತಂ ಸುರದ್ರುಮತಲೇ ಹೈಮೇ ಮಹಾಮಂಟಪೇ ಮಧ್ಯೆ ಪುಷ್ಪಕಮಾಸನೇ ಮಣಿಮಯೇ ವೀರಾಸನೇ ಸುಸ್ಥಿತಂ ಅಗ್ರೇ ವಾಚಯತಿ ಪ್ರಭಂಜನಸುತೆ ತತ್ವಂ ಮುನಿಭ್ಯಃ ಪರಂ ವ್ಯಾಖ್ಯಾಂತಂ ಭರತಾದಿಭಿಃ ಪರಿವೃತಂ ರಾಮಂ ಭಜೇ ಶ್ಯಾಮಳಂ. ದ ರಾಮಾಯಣ ಸೀರೀಸ್ ಪಾರ್ಟ್ 25, ಡ್ಯೂಪ್ಡ್ ಬೈ ಹರ್ ಡ್ವಿಂಡ್ಲಿಂಗ್ ಮೈಂಡ್. ರಾಮ, ಸೀತಾ ಅಂಡ್ ಲಕ್ಷ್ಮಣ ರೀಚ್ಡ್ ದ ದಂಡಕಾರಣ್ಯ ಫಾರೆಸ್ಟ್ ಅಂಡ್ ದೇರ್ ಮೆನಿ ಸೇಜಸ್ ಸರೆಂಡರ್ಡ್ ಟು ರಾಮ ಆಸ್ಕಿಂಗ್ ಫಾರ್ ಪ್ರೊಟೆಕ್ಷನ್ ಅಗೇನ್ಸ್ಟ್ ಈವಿಲ್ ಆಗರ್ಸ್ ಹೂ ಆರ್ ಟ್ರಬ್ಲಿಂಗ್ ದೆಮ್, ನಾಟ್ ಲೆಟಿಂಗ್ ದೆಮ್ ಪರ್ಫಾರ್ಮ್ ದೇರ್ ರಿಚುವಲ್ಸ್. ರಾಮ ಪ್ರಾಮಿಸ್ಡ್ ಟು ಹೆಲ್ಪ್ ದೆಮ್ ಔಟ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಟು ಡಿಸ್ಟ್ರಾಯ್ ದ ಆಗರ್ಸ್ and he decided to settle down in this forest, which he did. Then he started visiting the hermitages of sages nearby and was listening to all the good sermons given by them. He was waiting for the right combat to come so that he could go and kill the ogres. In the process of visiting the hermitages of many sages, Rama visited Sage Agastya's ashrama. Sage Agastya gave him many divine missiles and weapons. And this is a point to be noted, because the missiles given by Sage Agastya was of great use to Rama later on. Then Rama settled down in a place called Panchavati, according to the advice given by Sage Agastya. There he happened to meet Jatayu, the eagle king, who was also a friend of his father Dasharatha. Dasharatha and Jatayu were schoolmates. And on seeing Rama, Lakshmana and Sita and identifying them to be the sons and daughter-in-law of King Dasharatha, Jatayu was overjoyed. He treated them like his own sons and treated Sita as his own daughter, and took real good care of them, showering them with affection. Like this, time was passing very pleasantly at Panchavati. It was the onset of winter and Rama went to bathe in river Godavari at that time. It is said that Rama felt that the water was chill at that time, and the thought that occurred to his mind immediately was, "Oh my God! Here itself, in the middle of the country, that is Panchavati, somewhere near Nasik, and that is the middle of our country. Winter is cold here. I can feel the chillness of the water here itself. What to say about the chillness of the water in the north? It would be even more chill. What would my dear Bharata be doing now? How will he bear this chillness? He has also resolved to live the life of an ascetic, so he will not be getting warm water to bathe, and he is used to warm water. How will Bharata bear this cold?" Like this, Rama's contemplation went on. His mind and heart was very much with Bharata, similar to the case with Bharata, whose mind and heart was always with Rama. When Rama was thinking thus and bathing in the Godavari, a terrible ogress happened to see him. She was Shurpanakha, the sister of Ravana, the great demon king, ogre king. And on seeing Rama, she was immediately smitten by the arrows of Manmatha. Srinidhi Swami very beautifully describes this as of shloka with the playing with the number 5. He says, "Panchavatya mamum drishtva dvipancharatha sambhavam panchavarna jagne Dvipanchamukha Sodari. At Panchavati, this Shurpanakha saw the son of Dvipancharatha. Dvipancharatha means Dasharatha. Dvipancha is 2 into 5. And 2 into 5 is 10. And 10 is Dasha. So he has used the word Dvipancha instead of using the word Dasha. And has said Dvipancharatha, which only means Dasharatha. So at Panchavati, this Shurpanakha saw the son of Dvipancharatha. And on seeing the son of Dvipancharatha, this lady was smitten by Kamadeva, or the god of love, who is known to possess 5 arrows. And so is called as Panchabana. And this lady who saw the son of Dvipancharatha at Panchavati and was smitten by Panchabana was none other than Dvipanchamukha Sodari, means the sister of the one having 10 faces. And how has the word 10 been said? Dvipancha, 2 into 5. Who was the one who had 10 faces? It was none other than Ravana. So this sister of Ravana is described as Dvipanchamukha Sodari. So using the number 5, this shloka has been very beautifully constructed by Srinidhi Swami when he describes how Shurpanakha reacted when she looked at Rama for the first time. She was completely smitten, and so she went and approached Rama and asked him to take him for his wife. Rama laughed because it seems the Shurpanakha was such an oldie. She was an old lady. And how old was she is told by Bhavabhuti in his Mahavira Charita. He says, Aneka Yuga Jeevinya Treta Yasya Trayodashi Sachira Kantam Ramam Prashasyanti Nalajita. It seems the Shurpanakha had been living for yugas together, ages together. And this Treta Yuga, this time of Rama, was the 13th amongst the yugas that she lived in. She was that old. And how old was Rama? He was barely 30 at that time. And this lady got smitten by Rama and she came and asked if Rama could marry her. Rama laughed at this proposal and very honestly he told him who he was, that he was the son of Dasharatha and he was here in this forest to fulfill the vow given to his father, and that he was already wedded to Sita and he was an Ekapatni Vrata. He was not ready to marry anyone else other than Sita, and he introduced Sita also to her, who was just standing a few steps away, and he said, see, this is my wife Sita. As you can see, I am already engaged. I have a wife. But here is my brother Lakshmana. It seems at that time Lakshmana was making some repair on the roof of the Parnashala. He was getting some repair work done there. He was doing, thatching the roof. So Rama pointed at Lakshmana and said, this brother of mine is equally handsome, as handsome as me. And he has left his wife back home. She's not here. So why don't you approach him? Rama just said this in jest. And this lady looked at Lakshmana and felt, oh yeah, he's also handsome. This is not a bad proposal. Let me go and ask him. And so she flew to Lakshmana and put forth her proposal, saying that she was smitten with love looking at him and that she wanted to be his wife. Lakshmana also continued the jest that his brother had begun. He told Shurpanakha, see, you can see what I am doing. I am doing some work for my brother, who is also my master. So essentially, I am a servant of Rama. If you marry me, you will also have to come and serve Rama and Sita. Just think if you are prepared for that. If you are prepared for that, then you think and tell me. Shurpanakha thought for a while And she said, no, 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 that's a bad choice. Why should I live the life of a servant? I am not used to it. I don't want to do that. It's better I go back to the same old person who sent me here. And so she flew and came back to Rama and said, see, I don't want to be a servant. I don't want to marry your brother. You are fine for me. So please accept my proposal and make me your wife. So Rama said, see, as I told you, I have this wife of mine who is so devoted to me. I cannot ditch her and marry you. So please go back to where you came from. When Rama said this, this Shurpanakha got angry. She got so angry that she flew towards Sita, ready to gobble her up. Lakshmana immediately saw this and got into action and sent the knife running down, which chopped off her ears and nose. Tunna sudusinatthu Shurpanakha sorveidhi Tannai nayandalai thanmunindu mukkarindu, says Alvar. The nose and ears of Shurpanakha were cut off by the sharp knife of Lakshmana. And she had blood oozing out of her ears and nose, and she felt so miserable that she immediately flew away, talking all ill things about Rama and Lakshmana and swearing that she would take revenge on them. Now, Shurpanakha came being charmed at the sight of Rama, at the form of Rama. And we saw in the previous part that even the sages were very interested in enjoying the beauty of Rama. So when the sages were bent upon enjoying the beauty of Rama, Rama just suggested to them that they need to wait for another avatar of his where they would get the divine experience. Shurpanakha also came looking at the beautiful form of Rama and she fell for that. But here the story became different. Why? Because this Shurpanakha was not just attached to Rama. She had a dwindling mind. When she was offered something else, some other worldly pleasure in comparison to divine pleasure, she was ready to take that up. She never had a stable mind. She had a dwindling mind. And because of this dwindling mind, she got duped and she fell into the trap. And she was actually not interested in having devotional experience with the beauty of Rama. It was just lust that came to her against the devotional desire for beauty that came to the sages. So Shurpanakha landed up in such a plight. Shurpanakha went running to her cousin brother Khara, who was present somewhere nearby in the Dandakaranya forest, and with blood oozing out of her ears and nose, she complained about Rama and Lakshmana to Khara. And Khara said, don't worry sister, I will ensure that we take revenge against this Rama. And initially he sent 14 augurs to attack Rama. As soon as these augurs came, Rama very playfully killed them. Shurpanakha saw this from hiding and she went and reported this back to Khara. And then Khara and Dushana decided to march to Panchavati with their army to take revenge against Rama. Dushana was another brother of Khara. They came with an army of 14,000 Rakshasas, it seems. How Rama handled this, we shall see in the next part. Kujantam Rama Rameti Madhuram Madhuraksharam Aruhya Kavita Shakham Mande Valmiki Kokilam Yatra Yatra Raghunatha Kirtanam Tatra Tatra Krita Mastakanjalim Bashpavari Paripurna Lochanam Marutim Namataraksha Santakam Vaidehi Sahitam Suradrumatale Haime Mahamantape Madhye Pushpakamasane Manimaye Veerasane Susthitam Agrevachayati Prabhanjanasute Tattvam Munibhyav Param Vyakshantam Bharatadibihi Parivritam Ramam Bhajeshyamalam. The Ramayana series, part 26, The Healing Embrace. Shurpanakha's ears and nose were cut by Lakshmana, and she went enraged and sought revenge from Rama through her cousins Khara and Dushana. Khara and Dushana marched towards Panchavati with an army of 14,000 augurs, and they called out Rama for fight. Rama readily went with his bow and arrows, and Lakshmana said, "I will come along with you, brother." But Rama said, "No, you please stay back. You stay back safely in that cave there." He showed him a cave which was far away, a little far, but still the war could be witnessed from there. "You take all the sages and Sita along with you and go and stay in that cave." Apparently, by then, all sages had assembled there too, because Rama had killed the 14 augurs who were first sent by Khara as soon as Shurpanakha was injured. So by then, with all that commotion, sages had assembled there. So Rama told Lakshmana to take all the sages and Sita and keep them all in a cave from where they could witness the battle. And Rama singly went to combat those 14,000 Rakshasas. It was a battle which was unparalleled. Nobody could have thought of. Swami Deshikan describes it beautifully in his Mahavira Vaibhava. He says, "Karatara karataru khandana chandapavana." The tree-like augur called Khara was destroyed as if a cyclone came and hit it. And this cyclone was none other than Sri Rama. "Khandana chandapavana," he says. Rama was like Chandamaruta, the great cyclone, which made the tree called Khara fall. And then he says, "Dushana jalanidhi shoshana toshita rishigana ghoshita vijaya ghoshana." This Dushana came like a sea, like an ocean. He just came rushing towards Rama as if waves of an ocean would come. And Rama just dropped two arrows on him. He released two arrows on him. And Dushana just fell down as a wave would drop, reaching the shore. And then the great Trishiras came. Trishiras was another very powerful Rakshasa. "Trishira shiraha tritayatimira nirasa vasarakara." He says Trishira was a very dark complexion demon. This darkness called Trishira was dispelled by the rays called Rama. And all the 14,000 augurs were all put to an end with such ease as if an elephant would go and stamp on a pond of lotuses. How easy would it be for an elephant to go and stamp lotuses? So also was it for Rama to defeat these 14,000 Rakshasas at a time. "Dusapta Rakshas Sahasra Nalavana Vilolana Mahakalabha." Such was his valor. "Asahaya Shura." He needed no help to do this. Valmiki Bhagavan describes, "Chaturdasha Sahasrani Rakshasam Bhima Karmana Ekascha Ramo Dharma Atma Katham Yuddham Bhavishyati." What wonder is this that a single person, Rama, was able to combat 14,000 Rakshasas single-handedly without a chariot. He was a padati. He was just on his foot and he could combat 14,000 augurs at a time. Such was his valor. "Asahaya Shura." And in the process, did he hurt himself too much? Swami Deshikan says, no. "Anapaya Sahasa." He did not let any great injury befall him. That's what Swami Deshikan says. But the reason for Rama not having any serious injury will be told in a few minutes from now. Rama finished this battle, and this battle was being witnessed by the sages and by Sita Devi from far. Now all these sages were witnessing this battle. Why? Because they were given the privilege to watch how Rama fulfilled the promise that he gave to them. Rama said he would get rid of all the ogres troubling the sages, and now he had the opportunity to kill all of them at once, which he did. And the sages saw the misery that was befalling them go away in front of their eyes. They were so relieved as each and every ogre fell. As for Sita Devi, she was amazed to see Rama fighting like this. She had heard of Rama's valor. She had heard how Rama killed Tataka and Subahu and drove away Maricha and all that. But she had never seen it for herself. Now she was seeing it with her own eyes. And as Rama returned from the battle towards this cave from where she was watching, it seems she went running towards him and gave him a tight hug. She embraced Rama. Sage Valmiki says, in front of all the sages, Tam drishtva shatruhantaram maharshinam sukhavaham babhuva hrishta vaidehi bhartaram parishasvaje. In front of all the sages, she went and hugged her husband. This is not something that Indian women normally do. Even today, there is an inhibition to do such things in public. And Sita Devi was a woman of the Treta Yuga and the very embodiment of perfect womanhood. So, why would she do such an act? The shloka itself tells us the reason. It says, Tam drishtva shatruhantaram maharshinam sukhavaham. On seeing that Rama, who had slain his foes for the sake of the happiness of the sages, maharshinam sukhavaham. Why did Rama endure such a great battle? Only to give relief to the sages. Now, he gave relief to the sages who were all watching the battle. That is understood. But this very Sita Devi was against killing anybody, be it an ogre, be it anybody who even caused harm to others. She did have her own story to tell to prevent Rama from doing this act. But now she is congratulating him by giving him an embrace, that too in public. Why did she accept this act? The answer is Maharishinam Sukhavaham. She saw that sages were happy. Which sages were happy? Now there's a secret here. It seems that once upon a time, there was a famine in the Ganges. And many sages present surrounding the banks of the Ganges doing tapas found it difficult to live there. And so they migrated towards the south and they came to Dandakaranya, where sage Gautama sustained them and gave them very good hospitality for many years, till the famine went away from the banks of the Ganga. Now there was no famine in the northern land, and these sages were ready to return to their native place. But somehow they felt a little jealous of Gautama, that we sages have been performing penance near the Himalayas and we did not have the power to sustain a famine. But this Rishi Gautama, who is down south here, and even here it was not all that good. The situation was not all that good, that there were good rains and good crops for sustenance for everybody. But because of the power of penance of Gautama, he was able to sustain these sages for so long. So how is it that this sage alone has so much power? This jealousy got over the minds of these sages, and they tried to make Gautama responsible for doing Gohatti. Meaning, they tried to make Gautama responsible for slaughtering a cow, which would incur great sin on him. Gautama sensed the minds of these sages and immediately said that you people do not deserve to be sages at all. Jealousy is not a quality that sages should have. That is something that only augurs should have. So you all should become augurs, rakshasas. Now, and at that time, all those sages became rakshasas. And they were 14,000 in number. So, these 14,000 rakshasas who were present now were all originally sages. And having killed at the hands of Rama, having been killed at the hands of Rama, all these sages attained their original state. They all became sages. These augurs all became sages. So those 14,000 sages now found their comfort. They were happy. So Sita Devi was happy even with this slaying, because slaying of the augurs actually redeemed them from the plight of augurs and gave them the status of sages. So Valmiki Rishi says, Maharshinam Sukhavaham. She was so happy that Rama actually took into account the feelings of Sita and only saved everybody even by slaying them. So she was so happy that she wanted to give him the gift of her embrace. Not only this, there's another secret to this. Sita Devi saw the valor of Rama and she actually felt bad for having said something about him back in Ayodhya. When Rama had refused to take Sita along with him to the forest, Sita had used a trump card of hers saying that if you do not take me to the forest, my father, the king of Videha, Janaka, will think that he has got me married to actually a woman who is in the guise of a man. Sriyam Purusha Vigraham, she said. But that was not true. She felt so bad for saying that, oh my God, look at the valor of this man. There cannot be one equivalent to him. Asahaya Shura Anapaya Sahasa. So now she thought that my father would be so proud to have a son-in-law like him. That is why Valmiki Rishi uses the term Babuva Hrishta Vaidehi Bhartaram Parishaswaje. The daughter of Videha felt happy and embraced Rama. So here he wanted to convey the mindset of Sita that she was feeling bad to have said those words to Rama that day, and that she was feeling that her father would be so proud of Rama today if he saw his feet. And finally, another reason for this embrace was, this was a healing embrace. It seems that Rama did suffer from injuries in this battle. But the moment Sita Devi embraced him, he was absolutely clean without even a trace of any wound, any scratch on him. So this embrace of Sita Devi was actually the healing medicine to Rama's injuries. And so it is called as the healing embrace. Swami Deshikan also very beautifully conveys this in his Mahavira Vaibhavam, where he says, Mahita Mahamrita Darshana Mudita Maithili Dridhatara Parirambhana Vibhava Viropita Vikata Veeravrana. Thus, Sita Devi's eyes and heart were fulfilled looking at this battle of Rama. And Rama too was in seventh heaven, cloud nine, when he got the embrace of Sita Devi. What better gift could he have got for doing such a wonderful deed? So, on this happy note, the sages Sita, Rama and Lakshmana returned back to their hermitage at Panchavati. The turn of events after this would be discussed in the next part. Kujantam Rama Rameti Madhuram Madhuraksharam Aruhya Kavita Shakham Vande Valmiki Kokilam Yatra Yatra Raghunatha Kirtanam Tatra Tatra Krita Mastakanjalim Bashpavari Paripurna Lochanam Marutim Namata Rakshasantakam Vaidehi Sahitam Suratru Matale Haime Mahamantape Madhye Pushpaka Masani Manimaye
वीरासने सुस्थितं अग्रेवाचयति प्रभञ्जनसुते तत्त्वं मुनिभ्यः परं व्याख्यान्तं भरतादिभिः परिवृतं रामं भजे श्यामलम्.
The Ramayana series, part 27. The heinous hermit. When Rama, Sita and Lakshmana were settled happily at Panchavati, an ogress named Surpanakha suddenly came and tried to have Rama achieved through her lust. But when Rama told her that he already had a wife, Sita, she tried to gobble her up, and in the process she got hurt herself by the sharp sword of Lakshmana when he intervened and pierced off her ears and nose. Surpanakha, getting angry with Rama and Lakshmana, wanted to seek revenge and so took the help of her cousin Kara, who came with an army of 14,000 Rakshasas to attack Rama. Rama single-handedly defeated all of them and emerged triumphant. After this victory of his, there was peace prevailing in Dandakaranya for some time. But elsewhere, it was boiling hot and steaming. Back there in Lanka, Ravana received the news that Kara had been killed. Kara was stationed as a representative of Ravana at Dandakaranya to disturb the ascetics from performing sacrificial rituals. So as soon as Kara was killed, Ravana got the information. And he also got to know of the background story of Kara's death. What actually led to that? How Surpanakha visited the hermitage of Rama, and how because of Sita she had to lose her ears and nose. And this created anger in the mind of Ravana against Rama and Sita, and he decided to abduct Sita, who was the cause of all this, he thought. As he went ahead to do this job, his uncle Maricha intervened and said, "Please do not get into this act. I know Rama. He is a very dangerous person. I have met him at Tatakavana, and he is responsible for my mother Tataka's death. So I would suggest you stay away from this. He is a human being, and he attacked and defeated Kara because Kara came for battle. So I think you should just let the episode rest with that and not probe further for your own good." When Maricha gave the first piece of advice to Ravana, he was a little sensible to listen to that. But as soon as he returned, within a short span of time, Surpanakha came flying to Lanka, and she had a big story to tell. She wailed out her pity and said that she sought revenge from Rama. Ravana listened patiently, and he was getting instigated to fight against Rama. Surpanakha saw that this appeal of hers was not enough to instigate Ravana to go and proceed towards seeking revenge. So she thought of another strategy, and she started describing Sita to Ravana. She said, "Rama is the most handsome man in the world, but his wife Sita is even more beautiful. She is the most attractive person, woman I have ever seen in my life. And such a beauty, such a wonderful person, such a charming personality should be possessed only by you, O brother Ravana," said Surpanakha. Now this worked well. This description of Sita created lust in the mind of Ravana, and now he decided for sure that he has to abduct Sita. And again he went to Maricha and sought his help for this project of his. Maricha persuaded Ravana to his level best not to get into this baseful act. But Ravana's sense was completely covered by lust now, and he did not have any ears to listen to Maricha. when Maricha persistently tried to persuade Ravana, he got angry with him at a point and said, "Oh Maricha, if you do not assist me in this project, I shall kill you." Now Maricha thought, if I do not help this Ravana now, he will kill me. If I help him, I am sure to get slain at the hands of Rama. Now, it is better for me to get slain by Rama rather than by Ravana. So I will choose that. I would rather prefer to die at the hands of Rama, the virtuous one, instead of getting killed at the hands of this horrendous ogre. So saying, Maricha decided to assist Ravana and they devised a plan to abduct Sita. According to the plan, Maricha took the form of a golden deer and started wandering around the hermitage of Rama at Panchavati. Sita spotted this deer and it really looked beautiful. She wanted to possess the deer so that she could play with it. And she very sweetly went and requested Rama to get it for her. Rama sensed something suspicious, that there cannot be a golden deer. This surely must be someone else in disguise. So he was a little reluctant. But when Sita persisted that she wanted the deer, he couldn't refuse, because Sita was not somebody who kept pestering her husband for something or the other always. She very rarely asked Rama for anything. So now when she so fondly asked for the deer, Rama couldn't refuse. He told Lakshmana, "You please take care of Sita while I go chasing this deer to get it for her." And saying so, he left the hermitage and started chasing the deer. The deer ran far away, leading Rama at a very great distance from the hermitage. Rama finally killed the deer with an arrow, and as soon as the deer was killed, his real form, Maricha, came up. And at the time Maricha gave up his life, he cried out loudly, "Sita, Lakshmana," and he mimicked the voice of Rama when he called out these names. So it would sound to someone that Rama is crying out for Sita and Lakshmana. So this was heard by Sita back in the hermitage, and she got so scared. She thought Rama was in trouble. That's why he was calling out to her and to Lakshmana. Rama himself was concerned. He was thinking, why is this ogre trying to mimic my voice? He sensed something wrong. Back in the hermitage, Sita was completely troubled. And she immediately told Lakshmana to go and help her, help his brother. Lakshmana was not ready to do that, because he somehow thought that this was all some play of some demon or ogre or some Mayavi. And he was so sure that Rama could take care of himself. Rama had just proven few days back that he could handle 14,000 ogres all by himself. So Lakshmana was not really scared. He knew that this was not a cause of concern, and it was more dangerous to leave the side of Sita and leaving her alone going to the help of Rama. But Sita was not convinced, and unfortunately she gave castigating remarks to Lakshmana and sent him to the presence of Rama forcefully. She said, "You must go if you have to prove your loyalty to Rama and me." Now, Ravana thought, this is the opportune moment for me to come and abduct Sita. So he took the form of a hermit and reached the Parnashala of Rama. Sita was alone there, and Lakshmana had told Sita to be careful with strangers before he went. Listening to the remarks of Sita, Lakshmana did leave, but he did not have a mind to do so, and so he very cautiously told Sita to safeguard herself from any intruder who could come. And here was the intruder, the heinous hermit Ravana, who reached the Parnashala along with his Kamandalu. And Sita, on seeing this attire of a hermit, thought that it must be a sage, and it was her habit to very hospitably receive sages, which she did. She gave Arjha and Padya to Ravana, it seems. She gave him water to wash his feet and asked him how she could be of service to him. Ravana was dazzled to see the form of Sita. She was so charming. So he couldn't hide his identity for too long. He disclosed that he was the king of Rakshasas, Ravana, and that he wished to possess Sita. Listening to this, Sita was completely taken aback. She was so scared, and at the same time she had so much contempt for this ogre who was present in front of her, that she said, "How dare you think that I can even think of giving up this life with my husband and coming with you? Who are you? You are just a mere jackal in front of my husband, who is like the lion. You are like a crow in front of my Rama, who is like Garuda. You are like sewage in front of my Rama, who is like the Samudra, the sea. You are like a cat in front of my Rama, who is like an elephant. Tvam punar jambukaha simhin maam ichchasi durlabham naham shakya tvaya srishtum adityasya prabhayatha." You are like a jackal who wants to take up the food kept for a lion. You cannot even think of separating me from Rama because I am like the ray of the sun called Rama. Now something very similar to this has been sung by Andal in her Nachiyar Thirumoli. It is said that Andal wanted to marry the Lord, and if she was to be given away to some other man in marriage, then it would be like the sacrificial offering which has been prepared for a yagya is taken away by a jackal. Vanidai vaalum avvanavarku marayavar velviyil vagutha avi kaanidai thirivador naripugundu kadappadum moppadum seivadokta, she says. If a jackal would come and smell the offering which was meant for offering to gods during a yagya, then it would be similar to me getting married to another man. So also Sita Devi here has said similar words, that you taking me away would be like taking the possession or food of a lion which has been taken away by a jackal. Apparently Andal got this idea from the Ramayana only. Now when she said these words, Ravana's anger was aroused even more, and he decided to get into action immediately. He gave up his hermit form and took up the fierce full ogre form. He showed his real Rakshasa form with 10 heads. Sita was terrified. He immediately clasped and caught hold of Sita by her locks and took her along with him in the Pushpaka Vimana, which started flying in the air. Thus this heinous hermit abducted Sita Devi, much to the grief of everybody around. Who were there around? All the animals, the creepers, flowers, everything was a witness to this pathetic scene. What did the horrible Rakshasa do after abducting Sita? We shall see in the next part.